of my forefathers, and give me the ability that I may do righteous deeds. Righteous deeds that will please you and admit me in the company of your merciful servants. What a beautiful dua. This dua of Sulayman alayhi salam encapsulates for us many, many lessons. One, gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, thankfulness. That anything, if we have a skill or a talent, or we're able to do something very well, we should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. We should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. Then what? To thank Allah, to ask Him for the ability for us to thank Him. Two. Three, to pray for our parents. Because Sulayman alayhi salam asked Allah for thanks, to have ability to thank Him for his parents as well. So the third thing, when we make dua, we should include our parents in it. How wasteful a dua is if it's not, doesn't include our parents in it. So look at that. He praises Allah, he thanks Allah, and he thanks Allah for the bounty He's given him and his parents. Then he says, وَأَنْ أَعْمَلَ صَالِحًا, and give me the power to do good deeds. This is what a mu'min should be asking Allah for. The ability to do good deeds. Lastly, and admit me into the company of your righteous servants. To seek good company. This is the etiquette of a dua. We want to be in the company of people whom Allah has favoured. So, this was one story. Another story now, very quickly, we'll march on regarding the hoopoe bird, the hoodhood. And this is a truly beautiful aspect of the story of Sulayman alayhi salam. So then Allah jumps to another aspect of Sulayman alayhi salam's story. He says, وَتَفَقَّدَ الطَّيْرِ. So Sulayman alayhi salam was straightening up, you know, the army of the birds and everything else, and he wants to make sure everyone's in line, everyone's in position. Because he's getting ready to go out on expedition, a battle expedition. Jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's no joke. Jihad is a serious matter. Whoever is allocated a position has to be in that position. If you're allocated a post, you've got to be at that post. Your general's told you, you've got to be there, you have to be there. Matter of life and death, or it's a matter of whether the army is defeated or loses or gets the upper hand or doesn't. It's important when a general places someone strategically somewhere, that person stays there. Anyway, the matter of army and army allocation, where the contingent is configured and all of that, it's a very serious matter. So Sulayman alayhi salam was inspecting the birds. You know, he's inspecting everything, he's inspecting the birds as well, the part of his army, right? Then he asked, one of the birds missing. Yeah, Sulayman alayhi salam says, فَقَالَ مَا لِيَ لَا أَرَى الْهُدْهُدْ أَمْ كَانَ مِنَ الْغَائِبِينَ. Where is this hudhud? What, is he absent? He's supposed to be here. Why isn't he here? Everyone is here. All the birds are here stationed. And this hoopoe bird, this hudhud, he's gone missing. He's gone AWOL. So Sulayman alayhi salam, you know, like that. Every person or thing, animal that's supposed to be there is there. And that hoopoe bird's gone missing. And this hudhud, actually as well, Sulayman alayhi salam, some of the Mufassirun say, why was he looking for the hudhud? It's because this hoopoe bird, some of them say he used to shade Sulayman alayhi salam when he used to be walking with his army. Two, that he used to go ahead to find locations for water. So a lot of the parts is desert, isn't it? Because Sulayman alayhi salam ruled over Asham, Syria, Palestine, Jordan, Lebanon, parts of Iraq. This is the Bilad al-Sham. That was his whole kingdom. Yeah? So the Hudhud used to go ahead and find water localities for the army, so they can camp there. And so Sulayman said, where is it? Where is this hoopoe bird? Then Allah then Sulayman alayhi salam says, لَأُعَذِّبَنَّهُ عَذَابًا شَدِيدًا. I want to punish this severely. I want to punish this bird severely. Now some of the ulama say, how was he going to punish the bird? Some of them say, either by plucking its feathers. Yeah? Some of them said that to separate it from its kind, that was a form of punishment. Take a bird out of its kind, or lock it up in a cage. Whatever it was, anyway, he's going to do أُعَذِّبَنَّهُ عَذَابًا شَدِيدًا. I will punish it, severe punishment. This is a serious matter. I'm straightening the lines for battle, and this bird's gone AWOL. Then Sulayman alayhi salam says, وَأَذْبَحَنَّهُ, or I will kill it, unless أَوْلِيَأْتِيَنِّي بِسُلْطَانِ مُبِينَ, unless he comes to me with a good and valid excuse. I need to. So Sulayman alayhi salam, he's not going to kill him or punish him unless he hears his excuse first. And this is the way of fairness. Now, a qadi will never judge someone unless he listens to the case. He never listens to one side of the party and say, yeah, you're right, yeah, I'm going to punish that person because of what you told me. No, he's going to listen to both sides, gather the facts and so on, and then make a judgment on that particular case. So he says, أَوْلِيَأْتِيَنِّي سُلْطَانِ مُبِينَ, unless he comes to me with a valid, clear excuse. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَكَثَ بِغَيْرِ بَعِيدٍ. After a little while, Hooper Bird comes back. So after a little while, wasn't gone long. After a little while, comes back. Then Allah narrates what the Hooper Bird, the Hudhud Bird says. And listen to this, my dear brothers, it's beautiful. So, فَمَكَثَ بِغَيْرِ بَعِيدٍ. But the Hooper wasn't away long, comes back. فَقَالَ أَحُطْ بِمَا لَمْ تُحِطْ بِهِ. I have come across something, Sulayman, that you don't know. This is the Hudhud Bird comes back. Sulayman alayhi salam's angry. He's not in the place he's supposed to be. He'll either punish him, slaughter the bird. Yeah, these are the two possible outcomes it can have. And this Hoopoe Bird comes back saying, Sulayman, wait. I've got some news that you don't know about. He's telling this to a Nabi. I know something you don't know. Then he says, وَجِئْتُكَ مِنْ سَبَئٍ مُنَبِئٍ يَقِينٍ. I've just come from the city of Saba in Yemen with some clear news for you. So a bird, before even Sulayman alayhi salam can say, you know, what's happening, what's going on, he comes back and says, oh my God, I've got news for you that you don't know about. I've just come back from Yemen. And I've got something to tell you. So now he tells Sulayman alayhi salam. So Sulayman alayhi salam waits. He says, oh, listen. He's gone away, he's telling me something now I don't know about. I need to know what this thing is. So he says, Inni wajadtu imra'atan tamlikuhum. I saw a woman in that city of Saba, of Sheba in Yemen, ruling over the people. A queen ruling over the people. And they say this woman was Bilqis. Queen Bilqis of Saba, of Sheba, that the Mufassirun mentioned. She was a very intelligent, quite astute, politically sharp woman. Yeah? So, إِنِّي وَجَدْتُ إِمْرَأَةً تَمْلِكُهُمْ. I saw a woman ruling over the people of Saba. وَأُوتِيَتْ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. And she was given, looks like she's given everything from riches, you know, to respect, reverence, obedience, army. She's got everything. And Allah, and we read earlier as well regarding Sulayman alayhi salam, that Allah had given him everything as well. So this queen in Yemen, Bilqis, seems to be quite a powerful queen. And then the bird says, وَلَهَا عَرْشٌ عَظِيمٌ. And I saw as well, she's got a massive throne made out of gold and all these design and ornate, intricate sort of emblems and God knows what else. Anyway, she's got an adorned, massive throne. Then it continues, وَجَدْتُهَا وَقَوْمَهَا يَسْجُدُونَ لِلشَّمْسِ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. And I saw these people as well, bowing down to the sun, instead of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَزَيِّنَ لَهُمَ الشَّيْطَانَ أَعْمَالَهُمْ. And the shaitan has deceived them in their actions. فَصَدَّهُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِمْ فَهُمْ لَا يَهْتَدُونَ. And they have been misled by shaitan, and they're not people whom Allah has guided. Let's just pause here for a second. A Hudhud bird comes back. He's not in his ranks, he's supposed to be. Comes back and tells Sulayman alayhi salam, I know something that you don't know. And let me tell you what it is that this is a people over there in Yemen who've got a woman as a ruler over them. Ajib. Got a woman as a ruler over them. She's got everything. She's got a massive throne. A bit like yours, Sulayman alayhi salam, as well. And what, even more stranger as well, that this people do shirk. They worship the sun. This woman and her people are worshipping the sun. And they're a misguided people. The shaitan have فَصَدَّهُمْ عَنْ. They've taken them from the path that they're supposed to be. Meaning, the shaitan has misled them. Look at that, the Hoopoe bird, the Hudhud bird, comes back with a concern to Sulayman alayhi salam. A concern for Tawheed. That there's shirk going on. That this is a woman ruler. These are a people who are misguided by shaitan. That we've got to do something about it. Because the aim really is, for the Anbiya, is to remove izala to kufr wa shirk. Is to remove kufr and shirk. That is the maqsad behind jihad, isn't it, at the end of the day? It's to make the word of Allah highest, but it's to remove any obstacle in the way of Allah, of propagating the faith of Islam. And kufr and shirk are two things Allah doesn't want on the earth. Kufr and shirk doesn't want it on the earth. So, Think about us, a lesson for us, this hudhud, there's many lessons, but just very quickly. Are we people who are concerned individuals? When I mean concern, I don't just mean concern just about ourselves as an individual. You know, many people are fixated on, I've got to perfect myself. Brother first, yeah? Can't worry about what's going on around the world, Syria. What's going on around Libya, North Africa, Middle East? No, I haven't got time for that. It's just got to be me. I've got to focus on fixing myself. If I ever reach there, then I'll worry about branching out wider with my concerns. But that's not a believer. That's not a Muslim. A Muslim is the one whose concern is of his own nafs, but also of the wider Muslim ummah. At this time, it was about shirk. And, someone associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For us, that may not be shirk. May not be going around breaking idols. That may not be the issue. The issue is more serious. Perhaps, for example, the absence of the Sharia in our lives. The fact that there are designs on Muslim lands to put in rulers there that are exploiting our resources, not for the interests of the Muslims, or even the people of that region, but only to further the banks and the interests of certain Western powers. We need to think about these issues. The Hudhud has a beautiful lesson for us, to widen our interests beyond our locality, our postcode, even just these aisles, but globally, because we're an ummah residing here linked to a global ummah. This Hudhud is telling Sulayman alayhi salam, look at the shirk these people are doing, they're bowing down to the sun. That's unacceptable, Sulayman alayhi salam. We've got to change that. There are people whom shaitan has deceived and misguided. So very quickly, marching on. أَلَّا يَسْجُدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي يَخْرُجُ لَخَبَأَ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا تَخْفُونَ وَمَا تُعْلِنُونَ. And the shaitan has stopped them from worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who knows what is hidden and what is known in the heavens and the earth. And then he says that there is no one worthy of worshipping Allah. This Hudhud saying that, there is no one worthy of worshipping of Allah, the Lord of the Supreme Throne. And then Sulayman alayhi salam says, all right, yeah, fair news. Yeah. So he says, قَالَ سَنَنْظُرَ صَدَقْتَ أَمْ كُنْتَ مِنَ الْكَاذِبِينَ. Alright, we'll see if you're telling the truth or if you're one of the liars. So Sulayman alayhi salam says, alright, we'll give you your chance then. You come with a valid excuse, I'll take it on board. I'll take it on board, it's valid. It's about shirk, about a woman ruling in Yemen. Not that far from us, we can get there. They're doing shirk with Allah, that's a serious matter. I'm going to investigate it. Let's see if you're one of the truthful or one of the liars. اذهب بكتابي هذا فالقيه إليهم ثم تولى عنهم فانظر ماذا يرجعون. So then Sulayman alayhi salam, straight away without wasting any time, says, send this letter of mine to those people, send it to them, saying it to the bird, and then tell me what message they bring back to you. And you bring that message back to me. So Sulayman alayhi salam writes a letter inviting Bilqis to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at that. This is the job of a Nabi. Our Rasul did it, the Anbiya alayhi salam, before them did that. No wasting time, straight away, inviting them to the submission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Rasul did that to all the leaders around the region, the khusrus of their time, the rulers of their time. That Rasulullah wrote letters to them, inviting them to accept Islam. So the letter reaches Bilqis. Yeah? And now she's in the council of her elders. So the letter reaches, the Hudhud gives it to Bilqis, this letter. This is what she says to her council of elders, the people who she consults. قَالَتْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْمَلْءُ إِنِّي أُلْقِيَ إِلَيَّ كِتَابٌ كَرِيمٌ. O council, O chiefs, O leaders, a noble letter has come to me, an important letter has come to me. And إِنَّهُ مِنْ سُلَيْمَانِ. It is from Sulayman alayhi salam. وَإِنَّهُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. In it is written بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ, and the invitation to accept the submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Sulayman alayhi salam. Alla ta'lu alayya wa atuni muslimin. So Sulayman alayhi salam writes in there, don't be arrogant, Bilqis. Don't be arrogant. Come to me in submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at that, no messing around. Straight away, don't be arrogant. Accept the message that to submit to Allah. So on the letter, that's what was written as well. قالت يا أيها الملأ فأتوني في أمري ما كنت قاطعا أمرا حتى تشهدون. And then she's telling her council of elders, O chiefs, advise me, what should I do? So Bilqis, you know, even for her time, she did mashwara, she did consultation as well. She's a very shrewd woman as well, politically.